My name is Ed Dix. I'm the Director of Pharmacy for Inspira Medical Center, Mullica Hill. I've been with the organization for about 16 years. I oversee the day-to-day operations of the pharmacy, and I've been involved with a lot of the vaccine operations preparedness and the vaccine clinics here throughout the network. What vaccines are is they primarily introduce either a small portion of the virus or bacteria into a person so that their own immune system can learn that and it can defend itself and build an immunity against it. So there's a lot of different types of vaccines. There's old-fashioned live vaccines or live virus vaccines, which are a virus that's been inactivated or weakened. There are conjugates and adjuvants, which you basically have a vector where they attach a portion of the virus to basically help it get into your system, and that's how your body identifies it. And then we have these newer mRNA vaccines. And the mRNA vaccines are a lot easier for our body to develop an immunity against. It does not contain any portion of a virus or a bacteria. So a lot of people think that when they get the COVID vaccine that they're going to be injected with COVID itself and that they could actually develop COVID or they'd be exposed to COVID. That is not true whatsoever. In all of the vaccines that are being developed, none of them are live and none of them contain, the mRNA ones do not contain any portions of the virus. So the current FDA-approved COVID vaccines are the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine, which is an mRNA vaccine, as well as the Moderna NIH, or National Institute of Health vaccine, mRNA vaccine as well. Other than a slightly different composition of the lipid complex that surrounds the mRNA code, they are virtually identical. Multiple doses or series of vaccines are very common. So what it is the first vaccine, the first dose, gives you an initial immunity. So it provides your body some immunity. And after the first dose, we do see a little bit of efficacy. We see about, from the Pfizer clinical trial, about 52% effectiveness in preventing SARS-CoV-2 or COVID. And then once you receive that second dose, it's called a booster. It boosts your immune system and gets the efficacy of the vaccine to 95%. Yay! To an extent, any drug, any medication, any vaccine, anything that we introduce into a body could have potential side effects. People could have allergies. But common vaccine side effects are what we're seeing in all of the clinical trials, including you could develop a little bit of a fever, you could get some joint pain, you could have a headache or some pain. Mostly, I'd say everybody gets a little bit of pain, like you got a tetanus shot for about a half a day and then it goes away. And that's common for any vaccine. This is nothing to be alarmed about. And even the fever that people get or some of these aches and pains are not something that you should be afraid of, because what it does is it actually proves that the vaccine is working. It's showing that your body's starting to generate immunity to it. Yay! Some questions that I've been receiving is, if you have previously had COVID, is it safe for you to get the vaccine or should you get the vaccine? Originally, we wanted people to delay that vaccine for about 90 days. And the reason was we didn't know how much vaccine we would have initially, so we needed to prioritize to the higher risk people or your frontline workers in the hospital setting. And the reason is because within 90 days, the likelihood of someone recontracting it is rare, if not hasn't happened within a 90-day period. So they're protected for that 90 days. Now that we have adequate vaccine for all of our staff, we are pivoting and going with the new CDC recommendation, which was always to vaccinate everyone regardless of their status, but we don't have to worry about that 90 days. Some other questions I've received is if they're on an immunosuppressive drug or they have an immunosuppressive disease or an autoimmune disease, is it safe to receive the vaccine? These mRNA vaccines are perfectly safe for people to take with immunosuppressive diseases. The only thing you would see, you wouldn't have any adverse effects to you, but you may not develop as robust enough of an immune response. You may not get to 95%, you may only get to 70%, but that's just gonna be the nature of your own immune system. So there's no downside for it, but there's a lot of upside to it. So herd immunity is basically when you have a large percentage of a population that becomes immune to a specific disease. And what happens is once everyone develops an immunity, there is no host for the virus or the disease to jump from person to person to person. Now you can do that from being exposed to the virus and in beating it, or you can use it by, you can generate that immunity from a vaccine. And so from a realistic perspective, the loss of life that could occur if you just let the virus run rampant would be way, way too too costly. And all experts would agree that the vaccines would be the most logical way to get that herd immunity across for everybody to become immune. But a vaccine is not necessarily going to be useful unless we develop that herd immunity, which is why it's going to take many, many months, could take upwards of, you know, late next year or late this year, early next year before we get to that level of herd immunity. Studies have shown that you're not going to develop any immunity until about 12 to 14 days after that first dose. And even at that point, it's only about 52% effective. And then once you get that second booster dose, about 7 days after that is when we see the maximum efficacy of 95%. So any time between, you know, that first day or a few days before, upwards of 7 days after the second dose, until you develop that full immunity, you could potentially contract it, or you could potentially transmit it to somebody else as an asymptomatic carrier. So that's why it is very important that we continue to wear masks until we get to our level of herd immunity, so as everyone is immune, we can't transmit it from person to person. So vaccination is important because this is the only way that we're gonna be able to at least start knocking COVID down. It's not gonna be the one, the be all, end all, and cure all for it. But if we do that in addition to social distancing and we follow the protocols that we've already developed, the vaccine is gonna be kind of the nail in the coffin for COVID. So it's important that everyone receive a vaccine. And why? Because if we don't get to that level of herd immunity, it's really gonna be all for naught. So if we only get 30% of the country to get vaccinated, it really isn't going to change much of the unfortunate deaths and people contracting and the percentage of people who are developing COVID. So that's really what's key. As long as we get vaccinated and we get our percentages up for people who are immune, that's really why it's important that we get that vaccine.